Okay, animal services. You sure?
Okay. The first page has some of the great things that have happened with animal services over the past year. I know that I've spoken with probably all of you at some point individually over calls that you've gotten constituents or issues that you've seen related to animals. And I know sometimes citizens feel like that there's no progress being made and that nothing's being done. I'll point out just a few of these things. First of all, you'll notice that we are saying animal services now instead of animal welfare. That was a little bit of a communication issue with citizens because they had the impression that animal welfare was all about animals. When your constitutional responsibility is to protect the public's health, safety, and welfare, that means that animal services is just as much about people as it is about animals. So we have changed that name. And then also, the colors at the top represent their new uniforms. If you remember seeing them out and about, they had some old blue uniforms, light blue shirt, navy blue pants that were a little ragtag looking. Thank you, and the current budget, you all funded enough to move them to better uniforms. Most recently, we have one of the officers that was attacked in the city. She was bitten in the back of her thigh, and her new uniform pants saved a chunk being taken out of her leg. The old pants were those old whipstock pants, and the dog would just shred the pants too. The new pants are heavy enough that provides an extra layer of protection for them. All the officers attended training together in October. There's only one recognized certification for animal services officers nationwide. There's only a chapter of it in Georgia, and is extremely expensive. And there's a two-module certification, and it's thousands of dollars to get someone certified. So we found a 2.5-day training in Atlanta that within the current budget numbers we could send everyone to, and it allowed them to all kind of talk after classes about how the things could be applied locally, and they got the latest updates on the law. We had district attorneys there who prosecuted cruelty cases in court to help them with investigations. So it was a good training for them, and they met after they got back with the shelter staff and the director to talk about how they could implement some programs here. So there was a follow-up to that.
Did you say that lately?
They do hold it annually, yes. If you move on down the page, we had a meeting because one of the things we were hearing from some citizens that are tracking their outcomes in court, which is really good because they help with the education process, is that we felt like we were not getting as good at outcomes as we could. And it, Chairman, you kind of took the words out of my mouth earlier as far as the training, the investigation training, the law as it relates to cruelty. The new ordinance draft includes all of those definitions, so locally we will be up to speed on that. But because animal cruelty cases are not something that are seen often outside of the magistrate court, it did take some additional coordination between our county prosecutors, our animal service officers, as well as the judges, to build better cases. And now we're seeing significant improvement in these outcomes in court. We're also seeing, you know, when we talk about the question of when the officer gets on scene, is it cruelty? We met with our solicitor, Judge McCall, as well as representatives from David Miller's office, and our county prosecutor, who is Will Elliott. And we have talked about what those thresholds are. And now we have a process. Instead of, like some cases in the past, where maybe we initially wrote a ticket in magistrate court, which is the lowest court that addresses these issues, now if we believe there's any kind of possibility that it's actual cruelty, that we're looking at a misdemeanor or a felony charge, then we go ahead and go to the state solicitor. He looks at the evidence around the case, and he says, yes, we have the case in my court, or no, we don't. If we don't, then it's an animal care issue, and that person can still be cited in magistrate court. So it's not like it's all being thrown out, but it's the appropriate court. If you have something that's significant, like if an animal has or has almost starved to death, that the public expects a significant resolution to. But the law sets a limit on what magistrate court judges can hand down, which is 30 days in jail or $1,000 fine. So, you know, sometimes something so significant that people say, you know, well, that was dogfighting, they should have gotten 6 months, or they should have gotten 6 years. Magistrate court judges don't have the authority to punish someone to that extent. So that's why we need to start at the higher court, and then if he says no, then we bump it down to the lower court. The last one on the page is an issue that I'm not sure all of you are aware of. Some of you who work with citizens in the more rural areas might be. Horses. Several years ago, laws changed in Georgia where horses, once the old mare wasn't what she used to be, used to go to slaughterhouses. Well, now those slaughterhouses no longer exist. So we're seeing the same stray or...
That's not slaughterhouse.
Yeah. I was trying not to say dog food back there.
No, I'm sorry.
Yes, those. So now we have an overpopulation of horses, just like we do with dogs and cats. It used to be that you went to the sale barn. I grew up going to the sale barn with my granddaddy, so you've probably been as well. If you have ever been through that process, the animals that are kind of the has-beens at the end of the night, they'll kind of get them all out there and say, okay, who'll give me $500 for these two old mares or, you know, whatever. Well, now, no one wants them, period. So it's whoever's got room on their trailer at the end of the night, and they're taking them. And we've had some people who are the same people who may have hoarding tendencies towards smaller animals that are now equine hoarders. And they're thinking in their minds that there's a business opportunity, and they're taking on more horses than they have pasture to take care of, with the thought that they're going to fatten them up. We have 3 locations in the county right now where we are working with the Department of Ag through this process. But when we do have to seize a horse, and I think we've seized 2 in the last 6 months, we don't have a lot of large animal vets locally that are available to do those investigations, and it can be costly because obviously the animal is larger. So the staff at the animal shelter found a veterinarian out of Tipton, and she was very interested to partner with the county. She does this for other counties as well. She has a tremendous amount of experience in not only going to court and testifying, but also writing up the reports that the court needs, that the prosecutors need, regarding the condition of the animal, its prognosis for recovery, all those sorts of things. So for $125 per horse, she will come in and provide this, and even will come back to court to testify as an expert if we need her to.
So she takes the horse?
No. We have a pasture behind the shelter. So once the horses, once we seize them, we have to get them back up to an acceptable level of health if we can't find a rescue for them immediately, and then we try to adopt them out. Now, we have had some years in the past where we've not had any horses. 3 years ago, we had 2 mules that we kept for a while. So it you know, kind of just depends. We really try to get them to rescue if we can. But when you were talking about, you know, the big picture and being on the front end of a problem that's going to develop into something more serious down the road, this is definitely one of those problems that we have to stay ahead of. One of the locations in the county right now that we're working with the owner on has almost 40 horses. Probably 30 of those horses are not in great shape. If they were to decline to the point that the county had to work with the Department of Ag to go and seize them, there's only 2 locations in the state of Georgia that have room through the state to take these horses if they were seized. So a lot of that burden now is being put on local communities, and we would probably be in a situation where we would have to partner with someone here locally that had pasture and had fence where we could keep these, because we can't keep more than a few behind the shelter.
What do you guys, are there any local, so what you're telling me right now is that basically there are no local equine rescuers?
That's correct.
That's in our community?
That's correct.
What would be required for someone if they chose to do something like that to become a rescue team?
They would need to be licensed through the Department of Agriculture, which, you know, once you show, it's been my experience, that once you show that you have the appropriate amount of space, the appropriate amount of fence, that you are fluid enough to provide any vet care that was needed, it is. But you can imagine, you know, we kind of joke sometimes about there's no such thing as a free kitten.
Sure.
But we'll multiply that to the size of a horse, and it can be a lot for someone to take on. So it's, and then you still, unless you buy more land, you know, you've got to, you know, find the amount of space that you can keep them in. We have fostered a few in the past. Sometimes we get donkeys in. They seem to go pretty quick through the rescue process, or people will adopt them quicker than they will a horse. Mm-hmm. It's, it's never the supermodels of horses that we get or that we seize. It's usually those that no longer need to breed, or that, you know, or that 35-year-old mare with her sway back, and she's not good for much other than eating carrots and peppermints. So
that has really created a problem, and I really just, you know, breaking off into that. But just like you said, the fact that there's no longer any viable use for equine at some point in time,
mm-hmm.
it has created a real problem, and certainly it's going to become probably a larger problem to try to have to figure out what to do, you know, with some of these horses as a major issue. But yeah, I can see where.
And euthanasia is sad. Sometimes, though, it's the most humane thing that you can do for an animal. But when you euthanize a dog or a cat, there's not a lot of problems with taking care of that body after the fact, whatever method you choose. You can bury it on your property. The shelter can dispose of it for you. There's local cremation services now. We have vets that will send your pet off to be cremated. It comes back to you. But you can't put a horse in the back seat of your car and take it where you need to take it. So a lot of times, unfortunately, you know, we have to work with a local vet to have these animals euthanized on that property when that has to happen. Then we have a logistics mobilization as far as, now what do we do with this animal? Where do we take it? How do we bury it? What's done?
So. Call World Asher. He'll bring it back to the route.
Yeah, and that's what you got to do.
Therapy riding places, some of them would be interested in some of the older horses.
There are some. It's just that the market is so flooded with them. And you see a lot of people, even here locally, that will have joint, like, barrel racing facilities, and they also do therapy. And a lot of times it's their old racehorses that just don't have that get up and go anymore, that they know these horses really well, and that's their justification for keeping them. You know, our local farms are such a part of our small business community here in Lowndes County, because we have, you know, such a rural presence. I mean, that's still who we are as a county, and I think that you might see a little sign up somewhere, you might see a small volume of product being sold, but if you take the economic impact that all of those farmers and that all of those small places have on our community, it is significant. You know, they're putting food on the table, they're taking care of therapeutics when people don't have money to maybe go to a therapist. So yeah, they're pretty flooded with that stuff. But yeah, so that's where we are with the horses. I just want you all to know that there's some possibility for us to look at that in the future. I spoke with Linda and talked about what she feels like the shelter's biggest challenges are currently. This is in line with many of the things that we have worked with you all over the past year. Most significantly are dangerous dogs. I've been working with the dangerous dog process now for probably 10 years or more. And we used to have some years that we would never have a dangerous dog here. Now we have some months that we're having several a month. Unfortunately, some people are using animals to... they're turning them into weapons, and there's some case examples there that I have left for you. Or they're just not socializing them enough so that they're not aggressive. They're not upholding the leash laws, and they're getting out. So we've got to work on our education. The courts are helping with this process. If you see the last case that's listed there for you, there are criminal and civil charges that are still pending related to that particular case. But it is something to be aware of. I think that the efforts that your friend is calling as far as the tethering are going to help. And I know that people are so tired of hearing spay and neuter your pet, spay and neuter your pet. There are so many more benefits to spay and neuter other than just overpopulation, especially in a male ball, and that's where a lot of these bites are coming from. When you have the perfect storm as far as something, the negative part of what can happen is if you have a male dog who is left intact, who is chained to a stationary object for the majority of its life, that is going to be the most aggressive situation that you could create, and it is prolific in our community. That's where the majority of these bites are coming from. People are using these dogs as not necessarily guard dogs, but security systems. And they're chaining them just close enough so that they can reach the doors in some cases. And then kids come out of the yard, a stray dog runs through, the dog's already in a frenzy because the female dog next door is in heat, so he's all worked up and can't get off that chain. And then some kid gets too close, and then the next thing you know, they've been bitten in the face. So I think that the tethering is going to help us with that, but it's still an education process, and also letting people know the liability that they're facing related to that. Dogs on chains, we've already talked a good bit about that. In the ordinance draft, whenever we get there, we put in the tethering advice that you all put in, but then also, I think Commissioner Weisenbaker and Commissioner Evans also wanted to make sure that we took care of, and Commissioner Orson, you and I discussed this as well, the issue of chain abandonment. You know, it's one thing that because of their lifestyle or because of a particular animal or whatever's going on, maybe the weather's just nice, that, you know, an animal would be put outside like that. But we have some puppies that come into families, and once they're having problems with housebreaking, or once the dog jumps on the toddler or won't stay off the furniture, then you just get fed up because your life has got a lot going on already. And so the easiest thing to do is put the dog on a chain in the back of the yard. It never gets taken off of there, and people just throw scraps to it, and it gets a little water whenever the bleach bottle that's been left out there fills up with rainwater, and then you can have something to drink. That's not a healthy environment for an animal. It can constitute cruelty. Most certainly, it violates the animal care ordinance. So you will see in the ordinance draft that there's a definition for animal care versus cruelty, so that there's some options there. But it also addresses that chain abandonment issue. I know that some of the requests that we have from citizens regarding the chain issue wanted the commission to go to no chaining, no tethering, period. This is also a compromise for that, and it addresses the well-being of the dog if it's just been forever left on a chain. Feral cats are the next big issue. I think we've all gotten, Commissioner Weisenberger, I think we've worked with you on a case where people have called and they wanted cats trapped, or we have in many of our neighborhoods, people move and they leave the cats there because they're already outside. And we have some well-meaning neighbor who just puts, you know, may not even have cats, but knows that there's hungry cats in the neighborhood, so every time they go to the grocery store, they buy back cat food and they leave it in a motor cart and under the cardboard. And those cats are just breeding, and they're destroying people's property, they're scratching cars, people go to weed their flower beds and find an unexpected surprise they wish they had not found. So we have probably 10 to 15 actual feral cat colonies that are all over the county. The ones that I know about reach from the very northern end to the very southern end. There are families in our community that have actually sort of passed down the right of helping to maintain these colonies. And many of them are working with the Humane Society, who has received a grant for trap and release. There's a point of view out there that says, if these cat colonies have already established, you're never going to totally get them to go away. You can't eradicate the cat colony. Obviously, you don't want to do something that's inhumane to the cats. But for the most part, cats are wild, so they're never going to make good pets. So they trap them. They take them to the vet and have them spayed or neutered. During that process, the vet tips their ear, so if these cats ever come back into the shelter, then we know that it's a cat that's being maintained in the colony. They give them their vaccinations and stuff, and then the cats are just put back out where they were trapped, and they live together. People come by to feed them every day. The other point of view of that is these cats are destroying the songbird population. How well are they actually vetted? Because cats can have leukemia and all kinds of things. So there's two points of thinking there. The problem that we have as a community is that 70% of the cats that come into our shelter are euthanized, which is extremely high. But it's because the majority of the cats that come into the shelter are feral cats. And any of you who have ever tried to catch, pick up a feral cat, you know, you've got a tiger by the tail and you can't let it go. You know, it's not, they don't rehabilitate as quickly as dogs do. And they're, if they do at all, and there's just so many of them. So we have citizens that get a little aggravated because they just want the animal shelter to come out and take care of all these cats. Well, the truth is you could have a cat trapping team. You could hire an additional department in the county to do nothing but trap cats, and you couldn't stay ahead of this curve. So that really leads back to spay and neuter. The availability of rescues. I know we've all talked and heard a lot about getting animals out of the shelter more, and we have for you the next page over our statistics as far as our intakes go, our successful adoptions and rescues, our euthanasia, and all of those things. Our rescues locally and across the state are taxed to the max right now. There's two things going on there. One is a lot of rescues are trying to take care of sick and injured animals. In the budget, local governments do not provide funds for sick and injured animals. You can imagine the size of that line item with the dogs that we have and the cats that are running over by cars and things like that that happen. I don't know how you would stay ahead of that from a financial standpoint. So the rescues fill that gap in, which is why if you hear the chairman on the radio or talking to the public, we really encourage people to support the fundraising efforts of our local rescues because they are saving animals every day and they are doing what the taxpayers can with regards to maintaining sick and injured. But they are maxed out. Locally, we have several rescues who have veterinarians in town that are holding more than $10,000 in vet bills, and not a lot of rescues in anymore until those vet bills are paid down. So we also have a limited number of fosters. I think that with any percentage of the population in the community, we only have a certain percentage of people who are available or who will foster an animal. And right now, I think that our rescues have done a good job rounding those folks up, and we're kind of maxed out. Sometimes people end up adopting their foster. And I know, Scotty, you know what this is like because you have a rescue dog. But you get attached and you adopt that foster, and then now you don't have room in your home for another foster, so you're off the foster list. And that happens quite frequently. So Animal Services has become very aggressive in working with rescues outside of our area. We have worked with some transport programs to have animals taken to other states. The thing you have to be careful with that, because sometimes people say, I've got somebody who's got a van and they can take 50 dogs. Well, it's easy to say, you know, we have 80 in the shelter, take that 50 out. Now we've got room for more and these animals are going to homes. Well, you have to vet these transports and the rescues that they're going to, because there are some places who will, under the guise of rescue, will come in and scoop your animals up and then they get sold as bait dogs. We had a local rescue here many years ago that was burned by that. They were trying to get dogs out of the area, and it ended up the place that they were going, they were actually selling bait dogs. The other bait dogs, people who fight dogs, they want other dogs to use as bait dogs.
Trying other dogs, right, yes.
The other issue that we have is some of these rescues, because of the way they're funded, they will not take animals unless they are fully vetted and they have been spayed or neutered. Well, the county gets the money, the adoption fee takes care of the spay or neuter. So there's not a fund sitting there to spay or neuter these pets before we have them leave the county. So we have to find sponsors and partnerships and look for rescues that don't require that on the front end. And that can be a little difficult sometimes. However, the ones we can find we're working with. And the other limit that we have are probably 3 out of every 5 dogs that comes into our shelter is a bully breed dog. That is your Rottweiler mixes, your pit mixes, basically the big-headed dogs that don't look like Labradors and Poodles and all those sorts of things. Rescues won't take them because in many cases they're not highly adoptable. And that makes up the largest population of our local dogs that are being euthanized. So we need to really focus on education with people who have those dogs and areas of our community that those dogs live, so that we can get those dogs spayed or neutered and cut that out. We have dogs at my house. I have everything from a Chihuahua to an American Bulldog, and the Chihuahua would probably fit in the American Bulldog's mouth. It's that big. But there's no aggression there. I mean, she's probably one of the sweetest dogs we have. So these dogs get a bad rap because they have big heads, they have big mouths, they have big teeth, and people see them as aggressive when many times they're not. Weight loss, spay or neuter is the last challenge that we are really looking at. There is a program in our community that's called a low-cost spay or neuter program. Even with that program, you're looking at between $65 and $80 to have an animal altered, which for many of our citizens is still not a true low-cost program. They still can't afford that. Commissioner Evans and I have met several times with a local veterinarian, most recently, 2 weeks ago. And she has an investor who is willing to, for as far as the funds will go, make spay and neuter extremely cheap for low-income residents. So we are continuing to work with her there. The other thing, do you want to talk about?
No, we said the training in different locations, so provide some training for the residents and for some.
She asked a lot of questions, but one of the things that we talked about was how do animals get to the shelter? And when people turn them in, why do they turn them in? And we talked about the fact that usually it's because people can't housebreak them, and so they just don't want them anymore for cleanliness reasons. Or they're jumping, they won't sit, they're chewing up the furniture, those things. So Commissioner Evans talked to her a lot about bringing some classes out into the community so that people in the neighborhoods could just walk down and bring their dogs. The person that we met with said that she has some volunteers, some people who work for her that are really good trainers that are going to provide some of these classes for free. Housebreaking is the biggest one, so with your direction and Mr. Pritchard's blessing, we are already pretty much good to go at the shelter to start doing some house training classes on Saturdays. We think that we can handle 15 owners and dogs at a time, we've got people who are going to come out and help with teaching people how to housebreak their dogs, and that should cut down on the number of people who are turning their dogs in for that reason. We'll see the statistics on that next page if you want already. Does anyone have any questions before we look at the long-awaited ordinance? There's a summary that the county attorney provided. It is the first page before the ordinance draft. I know that you can all read through the ordinance. I'll go over a few of these things as far as the how and why. The first section, which is actually on page 2 of the ordinance, are the definitions. All the definitions now have been corrected. They all fit well within the ordinance. Our old ordinance was kind of 2 pieces that had been put together, so now it all makes sense. There were also things like vicious dog and dangerous dog that were redefined with the new state cruelty laws, and so now our ordinance matches those definitions specifically. Also, the provisions regarding fees are now conform to the current fee schedule. And the fees are listed several times in the ordinance. One thing that we have in here for you to consider is a lot of times whenever people come to the shelter to reclaim their dog, if they're repeat offenders, those fees double. They always have. But you'll have someone who their dog's gotten out for the third time in as many weeks, and now it's $200, $300, and they just simply can't afford it. Well, a lot of times the reason those dogs are getting out is because they've not been altered. So it's either, you know, a male on the prowl or a female trying to get out or whatever. So we have offered to them to let them adopt their dog out of the shelter instead of paying the reclamation fees. That way the dog gets microchipped and it also gets spayed or neutered before it goes back out into the community. And it's only $125 to do that. And the vet takes a look at it. And so we are trying to encourage people to use that as much as possible. And it gives people a break if they just, you know, truly can't afford that reclamation fee. Now, we do have some people who say they can't afford to get their dog back and that there's no way you're going to alter my dog because it's going to change his personality or whatever. The truth of the matter is, and what Commissioner Evans and I were told by our local vet, is that the hormone process that male and female dogs go through is dangerous to the dog. It can cause other problems. Male and female dogs can develop breast cancer from not being altered and some other health issues. So there's more benefits other than reproduction to having your animals spayed or neutered. The provisions regarding responsible...
Is that change for persons?
Yeah, all
good.
There are provisions regarding responsible dog ownership on page 18. One of the issues that animal services has had is whenever a dog bites someone or it continues to get out, it's whose dog is it? When you have roommates who live together, or my sister was living with me for a while, or that's my brother's dog and he lives in Florida, that sort of stuff. So that was cleaned up so that hopefully it will not be an issue in the future. Page 24, the section regarding the sale of household pets on public premises has been added. This has been a huge issue. We've talked about it many, many times. I think you guys are all familiar with the scenario of the parking lot puppies. So this takes care of the parking lot puppies. And basically what it does is it brings the matter into the regulations that the Department of Agriculture has already set forth. It should have an impact on any puppy mills that we have. They are very hard to find. Usually someone has passed or a puppy mill has gotten in really bad shape. Things to get bad enough for us to be able to find them because people use burn phones. They'll change their numbers. They'll change their name. They won't call you back. They know what they're doing whenever they're overbreeding animals. So this will help add a level of enforcement for animal services there. On page 26, the section regarding cruelty to conform to the current statutory law. This totally incorporates everything that the state says now should be in there as far as cruelty goes. We have had animal services look at it. We have had our prosecutor has looked at it. And everyone is comfortable, as well as the solicitor, with the language that we have on that. Page 27, the provisions on trapping and medical care. We had a little bit of an issue in one of the courts related to animal cruelty because if your dog is significantly sick or has a medical condition in general and you fail to provide proper vet care for that dog, then the state law before said that that was cruelty. Well, we were getting before the judge and the judge was saying, well, yeah, the dog's not in good shape and it's sick and it should have been taken to the vet, but I just don't know if I can say that that's cruelty. So there has been a lack of medical care section added that just makes that black and white. Either your dog is in bad shape and you've taken it to the vet, or your dog is in bad shape and you've not taken it to the vet. But that gives the judges an additional section to look at in the law if that's the direction that they choose to go in. And it also cuts down the frustration of the officers because they're writing cruelty tickets and they're getting thrown out. The provisions regarding chaining and tethering on page 28. That's one that we probably want to look specifically at. going to use, the length of the material, the difference between a cable and a tether have all been addressed. There will be some people, I think, based on the recommendation of citizens, that are going to be very pleased with this. There's going to be some people that may not be as aggressive as they want it. I think it's a good and fair compromise, because if an animal is being neglected on the chain, there's going to be other things related to that care of that animal that are already also going to be a problem. I think Commissioner Weisenbaker talked about this even at the last retreat, whenever we were talking about looking at the ordinance. A lot of times animals that are left on chains don't have a doghouse, or they don't have clean water, or you can look at them and tell that they're not being fed properly. So this allows for not only enforcement related to animals being chained improperly, but still, you can address those issues related to animal care frequency if you need to.
Hey, what's the difference between B4 and B6?
Is the difference between the cable and the tether?
Scratch that question.
And don't get me wrong, I know it's a lot of new changes and all of it. At the end of the day, I know some of the people can grow on, but I do think it is that urban and rural differences, as well as how some people have been raised, ultimately cultural differences that exist. In the city and probably some other households, because you know, you got to think, dog living inside is something new, fairly new to a lot of people in the last 15 years or so. If anything, if the most challenging would be this here section, just to be honest with you, I'm a straight shooter when it comes to things like a cable run. I don't necessarily see 18 provisions for it. It almost sounds like it's selling or promoting a certain company. I don't see how, I guess, even the trolley system can have less than 18 on itself. It's either it works or it doesn't. But that's just my thought. At the end of the day, in my view, I thought about it and asked a lot of citizens about it. And you know, the science isn't there to support. It's the difference between a pin and a chain, a tether. From the Cornell study to two or three other studies that I've looked at, they all say, you know, it's an issue of the dog itself, the individual working with the dog. And at the end of the day, just trying to, when it comes to tethering, it haven't been under scientific to say it's a difference between the things. And actually, there are studies that say that tether is more healthier for the dog than the actual pee. So just be mindful of that, you know, because at the same time, my heart goes out to that young kid that wants a dog. Parents say you can't keep him inside. Well, you got to buy an entire fence system, you know, in order to get one. And that's a lot different. So that's my main, I guess, at the end of the day. But the science doesn't support that it is a difference between the tether and the fence. I mean, I've read all the studies. So.
Well, I think you're right. I think it can be just as bad to.
It's about to be fine.
You put an animal in a pen and it be lived under an abusive situation even in a pen. I think the key is here, for one thing, is to try to alleviate some of the issues that have already been recognized, that the way animals are being tethered creates an abusive situation. And so, or a cruel situation. So if you can help that process by identifying a better way to tether that would minimize the cruelty side toward an animal, I think that really is what this is about. It's not necessarily addressing the fact that tethering is better than pinning. It's just that tethering and a cable system like this is better than chaining or tethering, we'll use that term, to a stationary object where the animal certainly doesn't know the fact that it's winding itself around a pine tree or, you know, post or whatever the case might be. That's where I think that's where this really comes to the point of trying to clarify that. At least to give the citizens, you talk about educating a lot of times, but again, this is one way that they need to understand, okay, if I'm going to have an animal, this is the way I need to tether it. If I don't have a fence yard, if I don't have a pen, if I don't have some way to protect my neighbor, you might say, from this pet, then this is the way I need to do it.
You're not limiting the owner, the pet owner's options. You're simply saying, other than chaining, this is,
yeah, if
this
you
is
use,
the way to
if
do it.
If you use chaining or tethering, this is the way you should do it. Because the other ways, we feel like, are unacceptable. And that typically have a bad outcome for the animal. Is that fair enough to say?
But that's why I go back when the studies say the difference between a chain or tether and a pin is no difference. But it, I guess the other side of it is just recognizing the fact that, you know, there are cultural differences, and I think within the city, limits is going to be probably seen differently than definitely in the unincorporated parts of the county. And I'm glad that we're working together with the city in order to get their perspective, because at the end of the day, you know, there are certain groups that may feel targeted, because when the science doesn't support it, it kind of makes it look like we work for PETA or we're working for veterinarians. And that's just the truth. And I love animals just like anybody, but I know everybody doesn't keep a dog inside.
Well, that's true.
So Paige
and I had something, we talk about this extensively, especially with the seniors and the kids who have pets, and that's the only friend that they have. They have nowhere they can take them outside. And some of them live in apartments that parents don't want them in the house. So what do you do with that dog?
Well, again, if I may, and if I'm missing something, please help me here. This is not an issue of whether you pen the animal, whether you leave the animal in your house, or whether you chain or tether the animal. The issue here is and what's being addressed is the proper way. If you choose chaining or tethering, there's a proper way to do that. And this is the proper way to do it. This is what we're identifying, or at least potentially identifying, as the proper way to do it. Nothing to keep you from keeping the animal outside, or keeping the animal in a pen, or keeping the animal in a fenced yard. It's just as cruel, for example, to keep an animal in a fenced yard if you don't provide it with shelter while it's in that fenced yard. It's just a fact. So this is just addressing tethering and how it should be done.
But see, on the A, it says that she's been unlawful to chain or tether an animal to a stationary object, period.
To a stationary object. And that's that tree or that
Or a tire,
whatever it might be, that's the stationary dog. Once it's on that trolley, so that it's got some movement back into it, that's what this is.
Have you ever seen one of those things?
I've seen them.
They work really good.
But I just,
you're saying your concern is that there are people out there who don't have a fence, who don't have a pen. All they have is a tree. And they can't afford a tether.
They got a doghouse, they got a tether, however, you know, of course they don't have a pen, and plus the dog don't stay inside at the end of the day. And it's prevalent in the city. It's prevalent amongst, you know, those who may not have as much money, definitely Afro-Americans, just to be honest with you. That's, you know, and a lot of them take care of the dogs, you know, but then you do have bad apples.
Well, I'm a little bit different than most, because I am a huge animal lover, and all y'all know that. My feelings are, it's no different than, I hate to use the comparison, as a child, but when you take responsibility for something, you got to take responsibility for it. If you don't have the wherewithal financially or whatever to have an animal, then so you don't have it. I mean, you said, talking about breaking the hearts of those kids who, you know, want an animal but can't, whatever. I mean, you also look at those four kids last year that got bit in the face by the same dog. So, I mean, I see your point, and I understand your point, but I think as long as everybody has options to have an animal, here's how you can do it humanely, then I don't know what more we can do.
Well, I think that's really, and again, without repeating yourself, which I'm going to do anyway.
I don't want to seem like it's classism or something like that.
Yeah, well, the issue here is, again, is not that you can't change. There's folks, there's citizens out there that would be as happy as anything if you just said, we're not going to allow a dog to be on any kind of tethers, period. End of the day, anytime, any place. There would be folks out there that would like it. Reality is that, just as you're saying, there are citizens out there that still ends up with a pet, however that means may be. But they end up with a pet, but maybe they don't have the means to have a fence yard, to have a pen physically built, and those sort of things. So their next option to maintain the area that animal lives in is through chaining or tethering. All this is identifying the proper way to chain or tether. I mean, that's all it's doing. You still do it, but this is the proper way to do it.
Are we going to furnish a plan, a list of materials?
Two things, yes, sir. There are two things, and I hope that this will address some of your concerns, because I totally agree with you, and this is not something that should target anyone. And Commissioner Evans really talked a lot about this as well. We do have people in our community that are doing good to have just gotten that dog where it is, and now you say, okay, you've got to go buy something, and they're thinking, I'm doing good to stretch that dog food throughout the entire week, and now they're telling me I've got to go buy something else. So we have a lot of great volunteers who already made donations to the shelter. So what we plan to do, if this is something that the commission adopts, is to work with some of our local retailers to come up with some packets of those materials that if you've got, you know, and go ahead and pre-package that for people. And then whenever we have volunteers who say, we want to contribute to the shelter, we want to donate, whatever, we say, okay, these are the packets that we need because we have people in our community that need to get on this system, but they can't afford to do that. The animal services officers already work with citizens. For instance, dog houses can be a huge financial burden for some people. And a lot of times it's that situation where they thought the dog was going to be able to live in the house, and now it can't, and now it's got to be outside and they need a dog house. But we have people who donate dog houses, and we work with people. You know when you get there and it's an indigent situation and people can't afford. So we have people that we can call and say, hey, I have someone who really needs a dog house. Do you have one right now, or can you build one for us, or whatever? So also, there'll be an adoption date for the new ordinance if you all choose to approve it. But there will also be a long period of education. It won't be a situation where the ordinance is adopted one day and the next day people are getting tickets for having their dogs not maintained properly. That's going to be a phase in the system, an education system, where we have to help people become compliant. The ordinance is not meant to punish, it's meant to help people and also help the animals in our community. So in that spirit, we should work with people as much as we can until they just say, you know, I refuse to comply, or I don't care what you say, I'm not doing that, or whatever. So there'll be a long process of that, as well as people on the board.
I'm not going to beat the dead horse, because I talk to people all the time, and the truth be told, they ask me why I'm not worried about the homeless, and different other things. So, you know, I respect what everybody's opinion is. At the end of the day, you know, this is just an ordinance. The other question I had was about the exhibitions. I know we had a circus that come in, and I saw the protesters before and everything. And I just, you know, the only question I have is, you know, how do you treat a lion humanely? They have the whip. You know what I'm saying? They have the tigers. What way are we proposing that they deal with those wild exotic animals?
Are you saying you're in favor of the circus? No. You don't like
circus? Well, I don't go to the circus because they have the wild animals, and then two, because it costs more than going to wild adventures. But I just don't know what is the humane way to tell them to treat their animals that they got to be on guard on.
The Department of Ag supervises the welfare of those animals that are on exhibition. They make sure that they are given veterinary treatment,
they make sure that they are fed properly. So that's the humane question more for those type animals. There are cases where those animals have been abused. For instance, by taking an elephant and whether they beat or they prodded that elephant in an inhumane way that has caused physical damage to the animal. Those are all issues that deal with, that the Department of Ag deals with. So when these individuals protest or whatever, what we do is make sure that that circus or that entity in town, they have the proper license and the proper documentation from the Department of Ag. That's just, and the reason, if they're coming to our civic center, since it's the county property, that's what we do. If they're at 5 points, that's the city's.
Linda and I had this conversation last week whenever we were talking about the ordinance in general. Whenever those requests come through, our current ordinance as well as the provisions here, allow for animal services to check those credentials to make sure that they are currently licensed. And Linda does pretty significant background on them as far as what we have access to as far as information goes. I think that probably in the past maybe 3 years, we've probably researched three. So far, we have not found one that did not have a negative history with the Department of Agriculture as far as either animals that were sick and not being cared for, injured, not being taken care of, or their enclosures were not proper, they were not being fed properly. You're correct. There are a lot of issues related to that. I think that it comes from trying to take something that should be in the wild and put it in a domestic situation. But the thing that she brought up right after that, in addition to it, was you have a wild animal and there is no real barrier in these pop-up circus environments between the public and that tiger, or the public and that elephant. And if you all seen any of the historical information, we had an elephant in the city of Valdosta about 100 years ago that broke loose and ran through downtown, and I think the police chief or someone in law enforcement at the time had to dispatch that animal. So you're right, and it is a real concern as far as the safety of those things. And there are some communities that have ordinances that do not allow those exhibitions to set up in their community. That would be something you all would have to consider. So.
I'm not sure I know several weeks, about 7 months ago, 5 months ago, the Democrat Party made something talking about animals. First, you have to see it all. Talk about the same thing. This is an effort to do that they have annuals.
Renling Brothers retired all of their elephants and their own companions. Moving through the rest of this, on page 30, there was a slight clarification related to leading animals in vehicles. As far as it being too hot for animals to be in the vehicle, that language was just clarified to something that the courts found more acceptable from an enforcement standpoint. On page 33, the penalties were addressed as far as the magistrate court goes. That was just a housekeeping thing that needed to be updated. On page 33, the fee schedule has been added into the text of the ordinance and gives a clarification there as far as fees for adoption and other things go. One of the things that we did add new language to make sure of is that the taxpayers were being compensated for any vet fees that the county had to expend on an animal whenever it came in. For instance, sometimes we'll get a litter of puppies and they all have mange, and it's significant. So it's not a lot of money, but it can be a few hundred dollars for a litter. we have to have our vet bring their staff in to scrub those puppies down and take care of those wounds. And in a couple of weeks with a little treatment, they're great dogs and they're ready to go to a loving home. But there is a little bit more of an expenditure there. Being that there's not a line item for sick and injured animals, we want to make sure that those adoption fees, if we have an extenuating circumstance, can take care of that if we need to. So that flexibility has been put in there. And then on page 35, again, just a housekeeping thing to make sure that we are in agreement with the service delivery strategy agreement as it relates to this ordinance. One of the questions that we've gotten from the public, as people have seen you all move through this process and consideration, is they think that once the county adopts a new ordinance, that that ordinance is going to take care of the entire community. As you know, one local government cannot bind another, so any ordinances that you pass, even though animal services under service delivery provides animal services for all the cities as well as the county, your ordinance will only address the unincorporated area. So once you get to a point through the chairman's community planning process, you all can move forward with communicating with the cities. We have a tremendous amount of data at animal services as far as where trouble spots are related to ordinance violations. For instance, the first three case examples that I listed as far as the children that were bitten in the face, none of those cases occurred in unincorporated Lowndes County. So as a community, you're right to identify this as a community-wide issue. It's something that we all are responsible for.
Do I hear a motion?